Scholastic Audio presents Dear America, Behind the Masks, The Diary of Angeline Reddy, by Susan Patron, read by Cassandra Campbell. For Richard Jackson, with love. Bodie, California, 1880. Friday, June 4th, 1880. Dear Diary, I know I'm going to have to look in Papa's casket just to prove he's not in it. When we heard he got murdered, Mama took it pretty hard. I would have too if I'd believed it, which I did not. Stabbed in the back, the messenger said, on the stairway between Mullinelli's saloon and Papa's law office on the floor above. But Papa's much too smart to be dead. This news was delivered tonight by a young clerk from the Wells Fargo & Company office, who said his name was Antoine Duval. He said, Madam, to Mama, and Miss Angeline to me, and explained that Wells Fargo was deeply saddened by our loss, which was also the town's. I think what he meant was that the town of Bodie would never have as great a lawyer. Papa had not once lost a case, even though he often represented rogues and scoundrels that everyone else considered to be guilty. And he'd recovered a lot of the bank's loot stolen during stage robberies. Mr. Duval regretted that the knife used by the murderer had not been found, and there were no other clues. Mama swayed a bit on her feet. She had received him wearing a black veil to hide her inflamed cheek, caused by an infection from something lodged under her gum. Yesterday, her cheek had swollen so much that it forced her eye to close. Since she was in some distress, I took the paper Mr. Duval offered. Look, Mama, I said to her, pointing to the signature. She frowned at it. This doctor must have been almighty liquored up, or else on a choppy ocean when he declared my husband officially dead, she said. Since his name goes above and below the line and all the way off the page. Where was the doc when he signed it?
Molinelli's,
Mr. Duval admitted. Everyone knew that of all the saloons in Bodie, Molinelli's had the cheapest drink, the crookedest gambling, and the worst brawls. Papa got a lot of clients just by going downstairs and offering his services when things got particularly loud. Well, I guess that's as good a place as any for the doc to practice medicine, Mama said as she ripped the paper in two and threw the pieces over her shoulder. But I believe he made a mistake about this particular death. When she gets mad, you don't want to be the person in front of her. She'll take it out on you for dead sure. I was glad that she had regained her spirits, but regretful that this young man was receiving the brunt of her fury. There are times when she embarrasses me nearly beyond toleration. Since I didn't believe Papa to be in the least bit dead, I felt free to observe our visitor. Mr. Duval had ink stains on his long fingers, a thin white scar from his forehead down through his left eyebrow, and a rare, gentlemanly grace about him. Dark hair curled at his neck, side whiskers shadowed his jaw, and a sharp Adam's apple jutted from his throat. His bearing was gallant and dashing. I imagined him as able to recite poetry while dancing a waltz, handle a dagger as well as a quill pen, strum a banjo, or kill a rattler. What I mean is, he had the air of a man of numerous and dangerous talents. So he got my interest. Antoine Duval bowed politely and tipped his Stetson to Mama. He turned to me and raised his handsome, tragic eyebrow. Then, he did a most shocking thing that I confide here and only here in my secret diary. He winked at me, as if we were in a saloon and I were some sort of fancy woman. Yet it seemed more friendly than forward, and I returned his look with wide eyes and pink cheeks. As he backed out of the door, I wondered if the wink was a signal, not of any improper attitude toward me, but about Papa's supposed death. Plenty of people had tried to kill Papa since he became a criminal lawyer. If someone finally succeeded, which is about as likely as church services in Molinelli's saloon, I wanted proof of it. Saturday, June 5th, 1880. Dear Diary, this morning, Mama and I went to Dr. Rawbone's dental office, as her infection was worse and she had developed a fever. The doc gave her a tincture of opium first, to lessen the pain. He said he would have to lance the boil on her upper gum, caused, he thought, by a bit of abrasive cuttlefish in that awful store-bought tooth powder advertised in the newspaper. Mama, fierce and calm, sat in the reclining dental chair. Of course, she insisted I observe and help. She had made sure I watched medical proceedings ever since I turned 7, and thus I had no fear of blood. I have seen bullets removed, knife wounds treated, toes amputated, bowels purged, and many babies birthed. I know nothing of the civilized parts of the world, but Mama says women out west need to be ready to do most anything, or someone is bound to die. Of course, many die anyway. I was given the job of holding a small gilded mirror in such a way that it reflected the light upon her face. For Dr. Rawbone's windows, none too clean, allowed scant daylight into the room. Each time he peered into her mouth, he commanded me to tilt the mirror to one side or the other. At last, he advanced and applied his sharp little tool. Immediately, a great deal of blood, streaked with straw-colored pus, issued from her mouth and filled the air with a nasty, fetid odor. The blood and pus ran onto a napkin tied around Mama's neck and onto Dr. Rawbone's hands. He wiped his tool on his vest, took a breath, and gripped Mama's head, for she had lost consciousness.
"Once more," he said,
and again blood and pus gushed out. I clutched the mirror, watching Dr. Rawbone, trying to breathe shallowly as the stench was horrible. He seemed sure and quick, I'll give him that. He pressed the gum with a whiskey-soaked handkerchief, wiping his tool again on his vest before returning it to the jumble of other picks and probes on a tray. Among the tools was a half-smoked cigar, which he lit.
"Foul taste, pus. Swab it with whiskey."
He seemed to be muttering to himself, but I paid attention in case he said something important.
"Rinse. Warm, salty water."
He peered at me from around a cloud of smoke.
"See to it. 3 times a day.
He frowned at Mama, then at me.
"Get to the apothecary while she recovers. Buy laudanum. Buy a quantity. Be back here in 30 minutes.
I hurried down Main Street to the pharmacy, bought the medicine and a few penny candies, and with plenty of time left, nipped around behind Ward's furniture and undertaking shop. Mr. Ward had a fine display of coffins, a rocking chair, and a curio cabinet in the front window, but I was interested in what was hidden in the back room. No need to tiptoe, either. Carpenters hammered on 3 different buildings, a team of horses and mules pulled a wagon loaded with supplies toward the warehouse, and the stamp mill, of course, was pounding ore from the mines all day and all night. The racket from the mill was so loud and the force so great that it shook the ground. You could have screamed bloody murder, and no one would have looked up from what they were doing. Ward's back door, facing the alley, was ajar. I slipped inside. I figured the big casket was Papa's, because someone, no doubt using the charred stick that lay upon the sawdust by my feet, had crudely written on its lid his initials, P.R., for Patrick Reddy, followed by Esquire. I lifted the lid. Papa wasn't inside. Though I hadn't believed him dead, relief washed through me, for here was proof. There were also, judging from the weight when I hefted them, quite a few occupied coffins sized for small children and babies. These were grouped together to one side, and I didn't fancy staying long among them for fear their ghosts would try to seize me. I looked around Mr. Ward's back room in the gloomy half-light. 5 plastered death masks were lined up on a table. Faces of men remarkably precise in every detail of wrinkle and hair, lip and lash. None looked familiar to me, even the one whose gray plaster skin was still wet when I touched it. The velvet curtain separating the front from the back room twitched a little. A sickly sweet smell rose up, and I figured it wasn't wise to linger amid the dead and their ghosts. It seemed a good idea to get away from there, as Mr. Ward would not take well to my sneaking into his establishment. I grabbed the stick with its burned end and turned to go, wondering, if Papa was not dead, then where was he? As I made my escape to the alley, I glanced back and saw the velvet curtain twitch once again. I think the undertaker may have seen me, for I got a glimpse of his sour face, but can't be sure. I was peering through the road dust left by a passing wagon in the alley, about to retrace my steps to the dentist's, when a horrifying sight appeared from around the corner. A giant man with long, rusty-colored hair and drooping mustache, as huge a human being as I've ever seen, lunged toward me, cradling a woman whose hands and dress were covered with blood. A small Chinese girl jogged behind him. As they came closer, I recognized the wounded woman and I screamed, for it was my mother. I would have lashed that giant with my bit of blackened stick, except that my arms were suddenly caught from behind. I kicked backward like a startled horse, but my captor held me in a strong lock. There was a strange rushing noise in my ears, which eventually subsided enough for me to hear his voice saying over and over, "She is all right. She is all right. She fainted, but she'll be all right. We're taking her home." At this, I went limp and he released me. I whirled around and before thinking, I delivered a savage kick to his shin with my boot. He looked exceedingly pained and surprised, but my satisfaction was short, for I finally noticed the scar running through his eyebrow. It was the handsome Wells Fargo clerk, Mr. Antoine Duval. Furiously, for all of this was too much to take in at once, I turned back to the giant man who had lurched on ahead, carrying my mother in his arms as if she were a doll. "Wait," I called. "What has happened?" Mr. Duval was hopping on one foot, clutching his shin in both hands. "The dentist needed his chair for the next patient, so at his request, we were trying to take your mother to her home," he said through clenched teeth. "He said she will recover provided she receives the proper care, which is exceedingly doubtful if you are to be in charge of administering it." "Oh," I said, and felt my face redden. "And may I ask, what does any of this have to do with you?" At which he straightened up and looked at me levelly.
"I was having a private conversation with my acquaintance," he nodded toward the giant, "in front of the dentist's office when Dr. Rawbone himself emerged and asked if I happened to know the patient and where she lived. I did, of course, as well as the dreadful situation of your father of your father's demise. So I offered to assist. We were attempting to—"
"As my mother told you last night," I said, rudely cutting him off, "my father is not dead." Papa says I am as shy as a rabbit, and he would have been shocked to hear my retort to Mr. Duval. I was almighty perturbed, because I knew I'd be in trouble later for not returning to the dentist's office on time. With the result that Mama was now being carried through the streets by a stranger. That giant man strode back to us, easily supporting her as if she were a child, his massive forehead crumpled in worry.
"She wakes up for a minute, Antoine, and then she faints again," he said to the young man whose shin would have a large purple bruise on it tonight. "And her mouth bleeds still."
"Miss Angeline, you had better loosen her—"
Antoine glanced at Mama's tiny waist and paused, for it would have been rude to say the word corset.
"Her garment. I believe it is why she keeps fainting."
I knew he was right, and I blushed. Mama had asked me to cinch the cords of her stays extra tight this morning. "Kindly turn your back,"
I barked at him. He gave a deep theatrical bow, and turning, he murmured,
"Boldness is a mask for fear, however great, as old Lucanus said."
The words stuck in my frantic mind, for he was right. My boldness did mask my fear. "You, sir," I said to the giant.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.